Hardware interfaces are used to allow two or more electronic devices to communicate with each other. They come in many different forms, the most well known of which are wired connections such as USB, HDMI, CAN, and the like. These hardware interfaces are used so that various devices, such as monitors and printers, can communicate with a computer. But today we want to look at communication on a lower level. We want to know how the microchips inside these devices talk to each other. Let's find out. Consider an example with two people who want to talk to each other. If both people talk at exactly the same time, they will not hear what the other person has said. In addition, the two people must speak the same language. Otherwise, one will not understand anything the other says. It becomes even more complicated when several people want to talk to each other at the same time. You see, all participants must adhere to certain rules. Otherwise, the communication will not work. These rules are defined by means of a communication protocol. The properties of hardware interfaces can be viewed from many perspectives. In general, interfaces enable the transfer of discrete information between two or more models. This discrete information is generally transmitted as a binary digit or bit for short. Therefore, first of all, high and low levels, as well as the order and interpretation of bits, have to be defined for all hardware involved. This results in a communication protocol. If, for example, it is determined that a high level of plus 5 volts represents the logical value 1 and the low level 0 volts represents the logical value 0, the transfer of data can take place via a cable in one direction. The receiver therefore decides which state, 0 or 1, has been transmitted based on the potential on the transmission line in relation to the reference potential. This technique is called single-ended signaling. It is often also referred to as an asymmetrical interface. Of course, the two models must be connected to the same ground. Although this transmission technique is simple, it also has disadvantages. On the one hand, due to fast changing voltages during switching from high to low or low to high, strong electromagnetic interference is emitted at high transmission rates. On the other hand, this transmission technique is also susceptible to electromagnetic interference caused by other devices. Such interference can change the transmitted signal so much that the receiver receives the wrong value. The remedy is the so-called differential signaling. Here, two lines are used for transmission, with the second line carrying the inverted signal of the first line. The information for the receiver is now contained in the differential voltage between the two lines. Thus, the receiver reads a logical 0 for a negative differential voltage and a logical 1 for a positive differential voltage. When connecting via a cable, two wires with the same impedance are used and twisted together to reduce the distance between the two lines. This way, the electromagnetic interference has the same effect on both lines, and as a result, the differential voltage also remains the same. After a comparator, the receiver detects the correct value. In addition to assigning levels to logical bits, it is also important to know how long a high or low level must be held to be considered 1 or 0. In other words, we need to know how long a bit is. One easy way to define the length of a bit is to transmit a clock signal in addition to the data line. Since a clock is a rather constant oscillation, the edges of the clock signal can be used for timing purposes. With every rising edge of the clock, for instance, one bit can be considered valid. This is then called a synchronous interface. In an asynchronous interface, a transmission speed must be defined in advance. From this, the duration of a bit can be calculated. Now the data is sampled in the middle of the bit. With the advantage of not needing an additional clock line, asynchronous interfaces also have disadvantages. Since digital circuits of this type are always connected to a clock source, the level of the signal can only be read at a discrete point in time, for example, at the rising edge of the clock signal. Let us now assume that the transmission time of a bit corresponds to 4 times the period of the clock signal. Then we can draw the discrete time points and the sampling time points into the signal. The discrete counter starts exactly at the falling edge of the start bit. But be aware, in reality, such hard edges cannot be realized and are also undesirable from an EMC perspective. A real signal will rather look like this, but there is another problem. That is the clock sources. These are not synchronous in different devices and their clock rates deviate from the nominal clock rate to varying degrees, depending on the technology and environmental factors, like different temperatures. Since the clock frequencies of the clock sources can be different, it can occur that the clock frequency of the transmitter is faster than the nominal frequency and the clock signal of the receiver is slower than the nominal frequency. This means that the transmitter transmits at a higher transmission speed than set, but the receiver operates at a slower transmission speed than set. Now the sampling point shifts further away from the center of the bit towards the falling edge with each bit. In the worst case, the deviation is so big that the receiver reads incorrect data and thus omits a bit. One can solve the problem by using faster clock sources, so that one bit is many more clock cycles long, or reducing the transmission speed. The receiver could also use the edges to calculate transmission speed of the transmitter and adjust its own accordingly. For this, however, there must be edges in the signal. If, for example, only ones are transmitted, edges do not exist. Now, a so-called stuff bit is often inserted after 6 equal bits to force an edge. This bit is then recognized by the receiver and removed from the data stream. Speaking of buses, interfaces can also be classified according to their participants. If communication only takes place between two participants at the same time, it is called a point-to-point connection. If there are several participants at the same time, it is called a bus. The term bus is often confused with so-called parallel interfaces. With parallel interfaces, communication does not take place serially via one data line, but each bit is transmitted in parallel on its own data line. With the parallel interface, there is also an additional line that indicates when the data is valid. Of course, mixed types are also possible. Now we know exactly what USB stands for. It is the abbreviation of Universal Serial Bus. Let's overlook the term universal for the moment. Important are the two expressions, serial and bus. It states that the USB interface transmits the data bit by bit, or serial, and that it can be used a bus, which means that it can talk to several participants. A further classification can be made if one considers whether it is possible to receive and send data at the same time. If communication is only possible in one direction, it is called a unidirectional or half-duplex interface, otherwise bidirectional or full-duplex. USB, for instance, was originally designed as unidirectional interface with two data lines for differential signaling. Since the USB-C plug and the USB-3 protocol, also bidirectional communication is possible. Now that we have defined some characteristics, we will look at some protocols. As a first simple example, the Universal Asynchronous Receiver-Transmitter Interface, or UART for short. For a bidirectional connection, there are two data lines, usually designated as TX for sending the data and RX for receiving the data. It is important that the TX line of one must be connected to the RX line of the other. The data is transmitted serially via the data line. As you know by now, this means that the bits are transmitted one after the other. If no data is transmitted, the data line has the logical value 1. For example, we want to transmit the value 5 here. If we want to express the number 5 with 8 bits, we get 5 zeros followed by 101. The transmitter starts the transmission with the start bit, which is always 0. Then the data bits follow, starting with the least significant bit. So we practically need to read the data backwards. The data block is optionally followed by a parity bit. We will omit this for now. The transmission is concluded with 1 or 2 stop bits. The example shows why a start bit is necessary. This ensures that each frame start can be reliably recognized by the receiver through the signal edge at the beginning. After the stop bit, the next frame can follow. It should be mentioned that errors can occur in any transmission due to disturbances in the environment. There is no 100% certainty of error-free transmission. Suitable error detection and correction methods can therefore only reduce the probability of errors. The previously mentioned parity bit is such a very simple method of error detection. To detect an error, the transmitter and receiver must first define a common rule. This rule is, for example, that the number of high states in a transmission must be even. To guarantee that the rule is fulfilled, the parity bit is used. The transmitter counts the number of high states in the transmitted data and then sets the parity bit to either high or low, so that the total number of high states in the transmission is even. The receiver knows of the rule and again counts the number of high states in the incoming transmission. If this number is not even, the receiver knows that at least one error has occurred during the transmission. In this case, the receiver can ask the transmitter to repeat the transmission again. Let's look at our previous example and assume that both devices know of the rule that the number of high states must be even. You can see the even parity bit added to the previous example. Since there are two ones in the data, which is an even number of ones, it has the value 0. If you now change one bit, the receiver can detect that the number of ones is odd and thus an error has occurred during the transmission. But this detection method has a major flaw, because if you now change two bits, the error can no longer be detected by the receiver. With this simple error detection, the receiver can only reliably detect whether either one or an odd number of bits flipped during transmission. For several bit errors, more redundant bits must be transmitted after the data as a checksum. For the transmission to work, both participants must of course know the right transmission speed, but also the number of data bits, the stop bits, and the setting of the parity bit must match before the communication occurs. The UART interface should give you a first insight into how communication between microchips works. As you can see, there are a number of things to consider in order for the communication between two or more participants to work. Of course, there are more interfaces that can be used for communication between microchips. We will discuss a few of the most common ones in our next video. I'm Thomas with the Institute of Electronics. I hope you have learned something today, but anyways, thanks for watching. For the interested viewer, we highly recommend The Art of Electronics by Horowitz and Hill, and for our German-speaking viewers, Elektronische Schaltungstechnik, written by members of our institute.